Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Leo Corry. I am acting head of the Cohn Institute for the History and Philosophy of Science and Ideas here at Tel Aviv University. On behalf of the organizers, that is the Cohn Institute, in collaboration with Ariela and Gideon Akavia, I want to extend you a warm welcome to this symposium that celebrates the publication of the book Subjectivity in Motion, Life, Art, and Movement in the Work of Hermann Rorschach. The book was written by the late Naamah Akavia, and it was posthumously published by mediation of many good people, who are to be heartily thanked for making its appearance possible. In the first place, Paul Stepanski, John Kerr, and Jose Brunner. Naamah Akavia passed away on February 2010 after lengthy months of courageous struggle with her illness. In 2003, Naamah graduated summa cum laude with a master's degree from the Cohn Institute, and she was awarded the Amos Funkenschen Prize for her thesis, written under the supervision of Jose Brunner, on Binz Wagner's Case of Ellen West. Naamah subsequently enrolled in the History Department of UCLA for doctoral studies, at the center of which was a PhD dissertation on the question of human movement in the work of Hermann Rorschach. The members of her dissertation committee were Norton Wise, Carlo Ginzburg, Joel Breslow, and Todd Pressner. Naamah's unique strength of spirit and her uncompromising determination not to give up allowed her to complete the dissertation, and as Ariel and Gideon movingly wrote in the preface to the book, she kept working on the manuscript of this book to the last day, knowing well she will not live to see it in print. Academic events to celebrate the publication of a new book are always a source of great joy. These events are comparable to those where we present our newborn children to colleagues, to friends, and to loved ones. Indeed, many of us typically relate to our books somehow as we relate to our kids. You have to work hard and invest years of your best efforts and love, and at the same time, you have to be prepared to expect nothing in return. Yes, if we are lucky, our books become famous and affluent, and at an older age, we can trust on their support, both moral and financial, when the time comes for us to require that support. Alternatively, they may also be those who need our continued support well after we had assumed that the rearing period had been successfully completed. But it is always the case that we love and nurture them, and we proudly see them as the carriers of our own selves somehow into the future. Thus, on presenting today a posthumous book by Naamah Akavia, while we are filled, with deep grief about her untimely absence, I think that at the same time, the joy of publication acquires a particularly profound and hopefully somehow comforting meaning as well. We have planned this event not just as a social gathering of those who cherish Naamah's memory, but rather as an academic stage where from the remarkable intellectual legacy embodied in this book can be thoughtfully discussed. With this aim in mind, we have invited four highly distinguished speakers who will deal with different aspects of the rich contents of Naamah's book. And we have also allotted plenty of time for discussion so that all of you in the audience may also partake and contribute. I will introduce each of the speakers in due course. But before doing that, I would like to use the time that was allotted to me in order to comment very briefly on yet another aspect of Naamah's intellectual output that may otherwise pass unmentioned and thus be forgotten, and about which I take modest pride in having encouraged its publication. I already mentioned that Naamah's MA thesis dealt with Binz Wagner, Case of Ellen West, and that she was awarded the Amos Funkenstein Prize for this thesis. This prize is awarded annually at the Cohn Institute for an outstanding student's thesis, and the recipient also presents her work at the Institute's research seminar. I was highly impressed upon hearing Naamah's presentation and immediately suggested to her that she should submit an article for possible publication in Science in Context, which is an academic journal of which I was at the time the editor. She worked hard on preparing that article, and it took 3 years before it was submitted. But once we received it, the two referees that were asked to review wrote highly enthusiastic reports, suggesting, as usual, some possible improvements and minor corrections, but unambiguously recommending it for prompt publication. I am completely certain that they could not imagine that the text they were asked to read and assess was the work of a young MA student. The article was published in the March 2008 issue of Science in Context under the title Writing the Case of Ellen West, Clinical Knowledge and Historical Representation. This is recommended reading for anyone with an interest in the topics that we will be discussing here today. Naamah's own summary of the article is as follows. The case of Ellen West was published by the Swiss psychiatrist Ludwig Binswanger in 1944-1945. The case history depicts the illness, schizophrenia, and suicide of a young woman who was with his patient 20 years earlier. It came to be considered one of the paradigmatic studies of the newly established discipline of Dasein analysis, an attempt to synthesize existential philosophy and therapeutic practice. This paper analyzes the case study, employing newly uncovered archival material to expose important details regarding the treatment of Ellen West, a pseudonym, and the posthumous writing of her case history. The richness of the archival sources and the various historiographical characteristics they exhibit raise methodological questions about the potentialities and limitations of historical representation. The new data will thus serve as a platform from which to explore and discuss more generally the problems involved in historical reconstruction of both subjective experience and clinical knowledge, and the questions of authorship and intertextuality in the genre of case history. Binswanger's main argument was that Ellen West's suicide was an authentic choice, in fact, that it was the only possible end of her existence. In addition, Binswanger strove to legitimize his own diagnosis and employed the case to demonstrate the theoretical framework of the Dasein analysis, differentiating it from psychopathology and psychoanalysis. The article, or the study, became paradigmatic for his followers, but it also gave rise to strong emotional reactions from readers. Grief for Ellen West and her anguish, anger at her therapist and family members who did not succeed in abating her misery or preventing her suicide, and condemnation of the socio-historical conditions that impeded women like Ellen West from leading self-fulfilling lives. Naamah approached this controversial study by way of painstaking archival research on a wealth of documents that had recently been made public, and in which the treatment in the Bellevue Sanatorium was described from the vantage point of the patient and of her husband. This provided a unique opportunity to confront the descriptions of the therapist with that of the patient. Naamah did not attempt to locate the historical truth in any one of the two narrative strands now available, but rather, in a very illuminating way, to locate it on the very textual interaction between them. Nor did she try to come up with a clear-cut answer of what really happened in the sanatorium. She did not look for a depiction of the authentic subjectivity or experience of Ellen West herself. Instead, Naamah focused on the different textual strands that constitute the sometimes conflicting representations of this subjectivity and of the events that led up to the young woman's tragic death. Naamah strove to illuminate the constraints and limitations of any attempt to represent a psychiatric patient, her life and death, her illness, her therapy, and to bridge the theory and practice of psychotherapy via the genre of case history. Her reading can be seen as an attempt to incorporate theoretical frameworks that stress the intersubjective aspects of both the therapeutic encounter and the writing of history, and the assumption that both psychotherapists and historian are professional storytellers. Naamah's article on Ellen West sheds original light on all these, on all the questions that she addressed, and I think that also in her book, which we are about to discuss today, we can find similar methodological approaches as well as attempts to address similar underlying questions. I want to thank the speakers who kindly accepted our invitation to come and discuss Naamah's book and some of the topics associated with it. And I do anticipate that all four talks and the discussions that will follow them will do full justice to her unique personality and intellectual merits. Naamah Akavia, Yeh Zichra Baruch. Let me now, making a very sharp turn, introduce the speakers. I will introduce the two speakers of the first session of this evening, and then I will let each of one present their talk, 30 minutes, after which we will also have some time for discussion. Our first speaker will be José Brunner, who was Naamah's advisor for the MA, and who was also involved, as I say, in the process that brought to the publication of the book. He holds a joint appointment at the Cohn Institute and at the Buchmann Faculty of Law, where he's in charge of an interdisciplinary studies program for law and the humanities. Since 2005, he has also been director of the Minerva Institute for German History, a position which he will give up in March 2013. Together with attorney Yossi Hayut, he established Israel's first legal clinic for the rights of Holocaust survivors, and he has been heading it since then. And since October 2012, he's the director of the Evan Mark Bezen Institute for the Study of Historical Consciousness, where he edits the international journal History and Memory. His main areas of research include the relationship between law, memory, and identity, the history and politics of psychoanalysis, the politics of mental health discourse on trauma, and several other related topics. And among his books, I want to mention Freud and the Politics of Psychoanalysis, 1995, and more recently, Die Politik des Traumas, Gewalt, Gesellschaft und psychisches Leiden. Sorry for that. After that, his talk, sorry, will be How Freud Attempted to Read Pictures. After that, we will have the talk by Janice Ross, professor and director of the dance division at Stanford University. She's a dance historian and critic. She teaches courses in dance, gender, and history, performance art, postmodern dance, dance in prisons, dance and popular culture, and dance criticism. Her books, I can mention a couple of them, Moving Lessons, Margaret Dubler and the Beginning of Dance in American Higher Education, Anna Halprin, Experiences as Dance, 2009, and she has published many other essays on dance in several anthologies, and she has also received many awards like the Stanford Humanities Centers, the Gerasi Resident Artists Fund, and the Guggenheim Foundation Award, and in 2010-2011, he was Fulbright Fellow to Israel. Her talk today will be about the dance in the inkpot. So as I said, I'm very honored to have four very distinguished speakers today, and the first two of them will now have the opportunity to start their talks. Thank you.